Veronica, and I'm from Whitefish River First Nations community, Native Canadian. My Muslim name is Zahra. Veronica and Zahra is basic, the same meaning. Veronica means flower in English, and also Zahra is flower in Arabic. Fatima Zahra is the daughter of Prophet Muhammad, and Veronica was a saint in the Bible, and she was known to wipe Jesus' face with a green cloth. And I grew up with four sisters and one brother. I grew up on the First Nations community until I was about 7 years old. And from there, we moved to a small town close to the reserve. But I was hardly away from the reserve. Every weekend, we'd go back and visit with my grandma and grandpa. And very close to Islam. Very close to Islam. Like, my grandfather would go out of his way to help people out. And my grandmother would be the nurturer of the house. And she would be cooking and doing the cleaning. When my grandfather brought people over, she would be cooking for them and serving them. And, you know, so I grew up very close to Islamic without even knowing it. I was Catholic, and I went to Catholic school. We always celebrated Christmas in a big way. Like, our house would be totally cleaned, and we'd all be waiting for the presents and everything like that. Just like any other person in the Catholic religion who celebrated Christmas. We were forced to go to church by my grandfather. And, you know, a lot of times I hated going to church, and it really bothered me. I didn't like going to church because I felt at a young age that church wasn't for me. I felt that the church are the ones who abused the native people, and I couldn't understand why my grandfather, especially my grandfather, would send us somewhere where we've been abused. I'm referring to when our people were taken out of their homes. Young children were taken out and put in reform school, where they were stripped of their language and abused sexually, physically, emotionally. It's well known, and a lot of people are coming back, and the government even apologized to the Native community for what happened to them back then. That I would say that was in my grandfather's year, like around 1942, around that time. A lot of them are starting to heal and get over that. And I'm just trying to fix the past of what they had to live through and their ancestors, what they lived through. I guess going to church is, for them, is one way of dealing with it. The other way is going back to their own roots, to believe in Mother Nature as they believe in. We learned the Bible in Catholic school. I went to Catholic school. We learned the Bible there, and I still just didn't feel it was for me. I tried talking to a priest one time, and he didn't give me the answers that I was looking for. And also, I always question, why does a priest not get married when we're all human beings? And, you know, and that's what God created us for, is to keep generations going. The part with Jesus, because we always, when we, you know, learned the Bible in school, we always believed that Jesus is the messenger of God. I was never, like, I never really believed that Jesus was the Son of God because of that part where, you know, I was taught, you know, Jesus was a messenger of God. So even when I heard of Islam and I heard, you know, Jesus is the prophet, it didn't, like, I believed, yes, that's right, you know, Jesus is a prophet and he is not the Son of God. When I was 12 years old, I really didn't... my grandfather was dead by that time, so I wasn't pushed anymore to go to church. I wasn't pushed by my mother, you know, like to go to church or anything. So I kept away from the church. And by 12 years old, I moved to Toronto. 13 years old, we moved to Toronto, and I met all these different religions and backgrounds, and I just found it amazing. And I thought, oh my gosh, like I wanted to ask everybody, you know, like all these questions, where they're from, what religion, and I wanted to know all that because I knew Catholicism wasn't for me, and I was searching. So when I was 17, I prayed for, you know, I prayed and I asked, God, please just send me someone good and doesn't drink and is religious. So just as I was turning 18 years old, I met my husband, and he started talking to me about Islam and told me stories about Prophet Muhammad and Fatima Zahra, and I fell in love. I fell in love with Islam, and I just remember wanting to know more because I thought, oh my gosh, you know, like this is, like I knew this was the truth. I really knew this was the truth. And so I started searching more and asking more questions. And it was that year, the year after I converted. And I did my first Ramadan. I remember doing my first Ramadan. And, oh my gosh, it was in August. It started in August. And I remember having these really bad headaches because I had migraines anyways. Like, I always had migraines back then. And I just remember, oh my God, like, I have such a bad headache. And this is so hard. But yet, you know, once you finish that day, you felt so good, and you felt, you know what? I can do this again the next day. And alhamdulillah, you know, like, I found, you know, like, my journey wasn't that difficult. Like, it was difficult, but because growing up Native Canadian, my grandmother wore a scarf on her head. Like, she just wore a scarf on her head. That was, you know, her... So for me to wear a scarf on my head wasn't a big deal. The big deal for me was when people, you know, were racist. Because back then there were hardly any hijabs. Maybe you would see one or two in Mississauga. That's where I lived. And you'd see one or two, or maybe even on some, you know, Tommy. And they would say, oh, look at that, you know, look at her. She's trying to be so fashionable, or... You know, they're just being sarcastic. Or they'd say, she must be bald. I don't think she has hair under there. That's why she's wearing that. They would say really nasty things to me like that. And I would just keep it inside, and I'd think, you know what? If only these people knew what they're really, you know, talking about. Because these people are ignorant. They don't know what they're talking about. I remember when we first moved to Richmond Hill, and there was a man, he was a white man, and he had another man with him, and a lady. He was driving a car, and at the time it was Price Chopper. Price Chopper used to be here. And he went running into me, and I'm telling you, I thought he was going to hit me. He came inches away and put on his brake at the last minute. And he gets out of his car and he goes, get back to your country. Get on your camel and get back to your country. And so I thought, my goodness, if this man knows I'm from First Nations people and I belong in this country more than anybody else, he would bite his tongue right now. But I didn't bother saying anything. I thought, you know what? I'll just keep walking and going, you know. So I just kept walking and going and just left him, you know. But I always believe what goes around comes around, and his day is going to come around. And you know what? Allah will record that to him too when he passes away. Allah will record, do you remember you did this to this person? And so I feel that, you know, like when people do that, I learned to say almost thank you. You know, thank you for whatever and have a good day. And that's what I tell people, you know, if they ever say anything, you know, racist to me, that's why I always say thank you and have a good day. I'd like to mention to all the reverts that are coming into Islam and they faced racism and hurtful words like that, is just to remember the Prophet and what he went through when they called him crazy and were throwing stones at him, and he'd just turn around and smile. And even the angel Gabriel came down and asked the Prophet, do you want me to crush the people? And he turned and said, no. And, you know, he could have had those people crushed. And even us, we could say hurtful words back to them. But you know what? That's not Islam. And we shouldn't. We should just smile and say thank you and have a good day. The Holy Quran, when I met my husband, and he introduced me. First he, you know, told me stories, and he seen that I was so interested. And then he, you know, slowly introduced everything else into me, like the Quran and everything like that. That was my dowry, was the Quran. My dowry was the Quran, and I didn't want more because I'm not materialistic. And for me, having the Quran was the best gift that anybody could have. Yasin. Yasin is the heart of the Quran, and it gives us protection, it gives us rizq, and it also gives us healing. I seen only one lady with hijab in Toronto before I became Muslim, but I believe she was from Saudi because she only had her eyes showing, and I thought that was... At that time, I didn't know what religion she was, but as I learned about Islam, it went back to me, and I remembered her as, you know, yes, that she was a Muslim. And I thought, well, she's really brave, you know, to wear, you know, that and go out. And so when I started wearing the hijab, it was change. It was a change, so I'm not saying it was easy. But once every day that I start wearing it more and more, it got easier and easier. And it wasn't a great big deal to me because, as I told you, my grandmother wore a scarf, so it was only natural like that. If I wore a scarf, it wouldn't be any different. No, it was over several days, like... or that whole year it took me. But I knew from this, when I heard the stories of Prophet Muhammad and Fatima Zahra, I knew this was the right religion. But just, you know, like learning more and starting to wear the hijab was, you know, a slow process. And then the fasting and the praying and all that was, you know, it took time. Like, I didn't jump into it overnight. I remember telling my cousin that I converted to Islam, and her first reaction was, she didn't even really say anything to me, and she actually put on the hijab because that was the day of my wedding, so she participated in the wedding by wearing hijab also. And I remember going back to the reserve wearing hijab, and it's like I went back there with, like, I always was like with my hair down and as I was before. And they didn't even say anything to me. They didn't even say, well, why are you wearing that scarf on your head? Why are you dressed like that? Why are you doing this? Why are you doing that? Why are you praying? Why are you, you know, they didn't even ask me anything. They just accepted me as I am. And till now, when I go back there, they're always really friendly to me, and they're always like just the same as before, you know, like it's not as if I changed. I guess, You know, I guess although, you know, people wear different clothing, they're still the same person inside. And that you can't change. Back in 1982, when I became Muslims, there was very few Muslims. You would see one or two or three, you know, maybe at the most. And so it was really hard, you know, to that first year for me as a Muslim, because I didn't really know anybody. I was just basically on my own until I met other reverts. I started meeting other reverts a few years later. And but that first year I went into it, I started learning how to pray. And that was, you know, that was, I think, one of the first steps that I did, was learning to pray. And then doing my fast. And with my fast, I was working. So I wasn't wearing the hijab at first, for the first year when I did my fast. But it slowly, you know. And then the second year, I started wearing hijab. I started my fasting. I was praying. I was doing everything. It just became easier and easier. And then there started becoming more hijabs by that time. Not very many still, but more than when I started. I went to the mosque only a couple of times, and the only mosque that we could go to was on Bayview and Steeles, that Jaffrey Islamic Mosque. And that's where I met other ladies that inspired me even more and helped me out through, you know, my experience. Fatima Zahra is one of the four great ladies of the world, and she's the one who inspired me. The strength she had, the generosity she had towards giving, you know, even her jewelry away to the poor people. The stories of her sons, Hassan and Hussein, how Hussein died and left his head chopped off, and she died at a very young age herself, sacrificed her life. And so I really looked up to Fatima Zahra, and when I heard her stories, I started crying. And I thought, what woman could go through, you know, such hardships and come out of it, you know? And another one is Sayyida Zainab. Sayyida Zainab, she spoke up, and she had so much patience. And she, if it wasn't for her and Zain al-Abidin spreading what happened to their brother also, I feel that there would be no Islam without Imam Hussein and Sayyida Zainab and Zain al-Abidin. So I really look up to Fatima Zahra, and as a woman, I look up to Fatima Zahra and Sayyida Zainab. But yes, of course, I look up to Imam Hussein too. But as a woman, we always look up to other women to get inspired. And mine was Sayyida Zainab and Fatima Zahra. Yes, I visited Sayyida Zainab. And I don't know what made me ask, but I just knew I had to go there and ask for patience. And when I came back, I found, I was back in, first I went to Denmark, and from Denmark, I asked my husband if I can go to Sayyida Zainab, because his niece was going with her children, and she asked him if I can go with her, and he agreed that, yeah, okay, you can go. So I went to say to Zainab, and I asked for patience. So when I came back, I went to Denmark before coming back to Canada for 2 weeks, and then I came back to Canada. And 2 weeks after coming back to Canada, I found out my sister passed. My sister hit black ice going to visit my uncle in the hospital that was very sick. She died instantly. And then my uncle was in the hospital, and then he died right after that. And a following few months after that, my son, Ali, passed away. And I thought, oh my God, that is the reason why I kept asking to go to say to Zainab and ask for patience. Even though, you know, like, I didn't know that all this was going to happen, but something inside you tells you, you know, like, you know, just go, you know, and do something. Like, Allah guides us, and He tells us, you know, like, what to do. And, you know, like, I really felt that Allah was pushing me to go to say to Zainab and really ask for patience. And I look back on it now and I say, you know, it's a miracle, really. It's a miracle that that happened, because I needed all the patience when I got back here. And He gave it to me. I got that patience, because I wouldn't have been able to survive all that without that patience. I just remember listening to Yasin after my sister passed away and my uncle. I just remember listening to Yasin and the Ot Wessel all the time, and asking for that help, because the Ot Wessel is for help. And I already felt that, you know, Allah, He gave me the patience. It was just the du'as and the prayers that I needed to help me through that. And then after, when I learned, like, my son was sick in the hospital, and it happened so fast. He got sick in January and he died in April. So it was really fast. And I just remember thinking afterwards, I remember saying to my husband at that time, it was the end of March, and I said, do you know what's coming next month? And he thought, and he remembered that we have another son who died in April, and his name was Hussein, and he died April 12th also. And I remember asking Allah, please Allah, just give me a miracle. Let this one, you know, let my son live. Give me a miracle. And I just kept praying, you know, like, just show me a miracle. And the miracle was that Ali died the same day as Hussein, on the 12th of April, 7 years apart. And I, at that time, I'm thinking, God didn't give me a miracle. I asked for a miracle and He didn't give me one. But I didn't think about it until later. I thought, oh my God, He did give me a miracle. He gave me a miracle that two sons of mine died on the very same day, April 12th, 7 years apart. And I look at it as a miracle, because I wouldn't want to suffer going through that twice in the year. Like, once is enough and hard enough. Never mind going through it twice. So that was a miracle, that he died on the very same day as his brother. Imam Radha was another amazing trip. I went there twice. The first time we went there was after Hussein died in 2004. And I remember telling my son to get a ruby ring. This was after we visited Imam Radha, and we went to the market. And I remember just seeing this ruby ring and thinking, Muhammad has to have that ring. Muhammad, you know, get that ring. And I was laughing and joking with him, and he goes, why, Mom? And I says, because that's going to bring your wife. And and we started laughing, and he goes, oh my God, Mom, you're joking. And so he got the ring and he went to Denmark, and within 2 weeks he was engaged. And I thought, oh my God, you know, like, at first I didn't even remember the ring. It was my son who reminded me, and he says, Mom, do you remember what you said to me in Iran? He said, buy that ruby ring and that's going to bring my wife. And look. And so we both started laughing, and it was, you know, it was really amazing. And also I feel that Imam Radha at that time, he really inspired me. I had no writing skills. I had, you know, I didn't even write. Like, I always thought my writing was really poor, and I wasn't very good in writing. Then I started just writing and started writing these poems. And my husband also was an inspiration, and he would tell me, you know, like, you go to what Imam Radha was about. He is the eighth Imam. So you start with that, and then you go through his story, and then, you know, like, that will help you to write your poems. And so it just started, like, all of a sudden I just started writing, and it just came to me all of a sudden. I couldn't write all the time. It would come to me on, you know, when I was really, a lot of times when I was really deep in sorrow, sometimes with my son's passing, I would think, you know, like, I would remember things that he did. And things, most of the things were, like, funny, you know, like, really funny things. And he was a really funny boy. He was 7 years old when he passed away, but honest to God, if you heard him, he was like a 40-year-old man. He was in so much pain. And do you know what he said? He said, Baba, just give me the turba of Imam Hussein, and I don't need morphine. Just give me the turba and I'll be okay. And he also died in Muharram, like Imam Hussein. And he was bleeding from all over. He was bleeding from his eyes, from his nose, from his mouth. Anywhere that was open, he would be bleeding. Because, he was on life support. And he also died of thirst. And I just remember, you know, like, oh my God, like, this is the hardest thing any mother has to go through. And you know what? But even though it was so difficult, Allah brings us ease. And I remember thinking that I was able to be in that room with him and to hold him as he was passing. And I just remember lightning and thundering as he was passing, just a great big sound of thunder. And then you would see a light coming through the hospital room with the lightning. And I just felt this peace come over me. A real sense of peace just came over me, and thought, let him go. Just let him go. And, you know, and he's not suffering here anymore. And I told them that he was the best boy in the whole universe, and don't be afraid, just go. Like, that was hard, but I don't know, like, Allah, he gives you the strength at that time, you know, just to pull through it. And I can't thank Allah enough that he guided me to Islam, and he gave me this beautiful religion. Because without it, all the things that I've been through in life, I wouldn't have came out of it. You know, I would, to tell the truth, I think I would be crazy by now. Alhamdulillah. Like I said, I can't tell you how much I should be saying Alhamdulillah every single second, every single minute, for me entering Islam and for God being with me and showing me all these miracles that I've seen throughout the years. Ali died on April 12th as well, but that year was, he died on Fatimiyah. And for someone to die on Fatimiyah, that's Ali. Before I go into anything else, Ali used to every day make sure his prayers were said. I wouldn't even have to talk to Ali. Like, he'd just go to his room right away. He knew, you know, like, oh, I have to start praying. And right away at a young age, he also learned Ziyar Ashura. And so he used to do that every single day, Ziyar Ashura. And subhanAllah, he died on the day of Fatimiyah. They say whoever dies on the day of Fatimiyah is of those lovers of really the true Ahlul Bayt and of Allah, because, you know, that's a great significance for him to die on Fatimiyah. So I feel that that's another miracle. And in 2012, the other miracle is I got very sick, and I didn't know what it was at first. I just mostly stayed in bed, and I thought, well, I haven't been sick in such a long time, so I'm probably just getting the flu really bad. And I didn't want to go to no doctor, no hospital. The last thing I wanted to do was go to the hospital, because I just thought, oh my God, they're going to diagnose me. And I always looked at it as a bad thing, because, you know, my two sons always were in the hospital, and I thought, oh, I don't want to be diagnosed with something really bad. And then a couple of friends of mine told me, and one of them is Sister Layla Hasib. She told me, let's go to the hospital. Let's get this checked out. And so Sister Layla took me. And we went to the hospital, sitting there and waiting and waiting and waiting. Finally, we were admitted, and they told me, oh, I think she has pulmonary function fibrosis. Pulmonary function fibrosis is, you either get that from mold or mildew or from farms. And I didn't know anything about the disease at first, but after I learned that pulmonary function fibrosis is when your lungs get really stiff and they're no longer spongy the way they're supposed to be spongy for you to breathe in and out. And so mine were just getting stiffer and stiffer as time went by. And it was getting harder for me to breathe more and more. So I was put on oxygen right away, like at the hospital. They, 2 weeks after I was in there, I was diagnosed with it. They put me on oxygen, and I came home with oxygen. And it was only a little bit at that time. But very quickly, you know, the numbers on how much I had to use increasing came fast, and they were increasing very fast. And I just remember being really sick and having a hard time breathing, and even going up the stairs would be just a great big challenge for me. And so I started going to Toronto General Hospital, and it was the third time probably that I've been there that a doctor took me and took me seriously. And they told me that I needed a lung transplant. And I was going along with everything, like, just so smoothly, and accepted it. But in the back of my head, I thought, oh my goodness, Hussein died at Sick Children's Hospital, Ali at Mount Sinai, and here I am in Toronto General. That's a triangle. And my husband mentioned the same thing to me. He goes, you know, this is like a triangle, like, you know, a perfect triangle where, you know, and it kind of scared us, like, it kind of scared me, because I thought, oh no, you know, like, this is, Hussein died at Sick Kids, and Ali died at Mount Sinai. Now it's maybe my turn to die at Toronto General. But I didn't go further into that, and I didn't think, you know, like, this disease was as bad as it was at that time. And I thought, I could fight this, you know, I could do it. And I even remember the first time they put me under and put me on life support, because I started bleeding in my lungs, and I was coughing up blood. And so I thought, and I turned around to them, because they were really scared, because the doctors told them that I have to be put on life support. So before I went on life support, I told them, don't worry, I'm going to be out of here in 1 week, watch and see. In 1 week, I woke up out of it, you know. And they go, Mom, it's 7 days, it's a week, and you're up and you're out. You said you would be, and you are. I says, I told you. But I was still very sick. I was still very sick. So they kept me in the ICU for 2 weeks, and they told me, you know, like, you really need the double lung transplant, you know, and we're going to keep you in here as long as we can to watch you. So they kept me in the ICU to watch me. I was no longer on life support, but I was on the oxygen. And it wasn't the regular doctor. This was about 2 weeks after. It wasn't a new doctor, but one of the other doctors sent me to the floor and thought, you know, that I'd be okay on the floor. And the very next day after he put me on the floor, I took my last breath. I literally took my last breath. I couldn't breathe anymore. And so they brought in, I just remembered them coming in and putting this great big plastic thing for me to breathe and pumping it in order for me to breathe. And I lost consciousness. And then I woke up. Well, actually, it was, I only had 10% chance of getting lungs. They had to go worldwide, nationwide, in order to look for lungs for me, because my situation was getting really bad, and they knew it, and they knew that they had to get lungs for me, otherwise I would pass away, I would die. And I'm B positive, and in Canada, B positive is rare. So that's when they went nationwide. And then when I took my last breath, was the next day. They had lungs, but they were meant for another lady, but she ended up with SPDIF, is an infection all over her body. So if they gave her those lungs, they would be wasting them, because she was going to die anyway. So, you know, they thought, okay, the next person in line is me, because I was already prepared. I had echo machine that was making my lungs. I had a great big tube in my neck, and plus on life support. And the ECMO machine was to help my lungs, to get oxygen into my lungs and for me to keep breathing. And that's how they were keeping me alive, from that ECMO machine and life support. And so they said, well, the next person in line would be me, because I was already prepared. I was already under, and, you know, they could easily do me. So I got the lungs, and I woke up, and I remember the nurses saying to me, do you know where you are? Do you know? And I couldn't answer. I couldn't speak, because you're so drugged up and on drugs that, you know, you can only hear what they say, but you can't speak. And because of the tube in your mouth so long, it's hard for you to speak afterwards. So I couldn't answer, and I just remember thinking, like, I could hear her, but I couldn't answer her. And so she's saying, you got your lung, you're in Toronto General Hospital, and you got your lungs. And I remember, you know, is this a dream? Like, am I just dreaming or is this real? And and it wasn't until I started feeling, I started hearing all the voices and more of doctors coming to ask how you're doing and things that I knew that I was in the hospital and I got my lungs. And just that alone is a miracle. Because what chances is that, you know, like you taking your last breath and lungs coming in for you. Meanwhile, they only told you 10% chance you're going to get those lungs. You know, that is a miracle from God. Anybody interested in learning about Islam or curious about Islam, to really look deep and in from the bottom of their heart, ask God, you know, to send you to the right path. And I always believe that you pray in your own little way, but if it comes from the heart, Allah will show you signs and Allah will give you the strength. Allah will show you that Islam is the right path. And although there's, you know, there's not always good times in religion, and because the closer we get to Allah, the more tests we have, because Shaitan is always there to try to misguide us and try to pull us away from Allah and try to pull us his way. But you just got to be strong and believe in Allah and keep it in your heart and ask from the bottom of your heart just to give you the strength and to pull you through your search, and he will guide you. He'll guide you to the right way. And Islam is the right way for me and for everybody, you know, like it's just the right religion. There's the 40th hadiths that, you know, that you could look into. There's also the Quran, which is a good guide. And the du'as always help you, you know, through whatever you're going through, because there's special du'as for whatever you want, whatever you're asking for. There's a special du'a, and there's special there's special verses in the Quran, surahs, that you could be reading for, you know, like I said, for protection, for, you know, for healing, for all of this. And I would just suggest that, you know, a lot of reading, a lot of research, and a lot of questions to people who have knowledge. Go to seminars, learn, just learn. I've always had a positive outlook for hijab and the beauty behind the hijab. And I always felt that with our young generation, it's difficult for them to wear hijab because they're going to school and they get teased a lot at school, or they get their hijab pulled off at school. So I thought I would write a poem about hijab and how it could empower us and the beauty behind it. And hijab is our protection also. So I wrote this poem and I'd just like to share it with you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Hijab. Hijab is not just a piece of clothing. Hijab is all the knowing. It's the concealment of a woman's beauty. It's not just the clothing. It's Allah's law and our duty. Like a curtain, you don't want it so revealing. It starts within us. The heart is the beginning. In other words, we can't afford to be sinning. We shouldn't be fantasizing. Our gaze should be lowered. Our voices should be soft, not overwhelming. Woman is like a delicate pearl or flower, something that needs to be nourished and protected. Like our hearts and souls always have to be perfected. We should be alert always. Watch our duties and boundaries. Allah made it mandatory. Allah is wise and knowing. A woman's piousness and purity is always glowing, like a flower that is blooming, needs to be nourished and fed. Our daughters need to be properly bred. We should be a mirror for one another with the teachings of our mother and grandmother. Take a look at Bibi Fatima Zahra. We are responsible for our actions in front of Allah. Who do we think we are pleasing? Once we die and are below the ground, we will be questioned. So don't forget your duty to Allah. Islam should be mentioned. Always remember, your reward is not this life, but the eternal. Consider it as a savings that goes towards your pension. So women and girls, always remember to do good deeds. It doesn't matter what color or creed. So women and girls, always remember to do good deeds. It doesn't matter what color or creed. Just think of our baby girls as seeds. They will grow up to be beautiful pearl or flower. It's up to you to give them the power. Only when we start to be humble and true to ourselves, but not until then, it should be called hijab. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya Ali, Ya Wali. When you were born, the Kaaba cracked and opened so your mother could enter to have a baby boy so sacred and divine. The Holy Quran is your root and your vine. The Prophet said, I am the city of knowledge and Ali is the gate. So be careful, beware, Islam is our faith. From the very beginning, you put people first, especially those whom quench thirst. Ya Ali, Ya Karar, you pulled from the roots of the fixtures, the gate of Khabar. No one else in the history of Islam done this but you, Haider. It took 40 men to open and 40 men to close. After lifting the door, you kicked it with your toes, made a bridge for your army to pass on, while never leaving your prayer and the turbah you worshipped upon. Then kill the biggest tyrant, his name Mahrub. Zawij, or husband of Al-Batul. Zahur, or son-in-law of Rasul. Slept in Nebi's bed to sacrifice your soul as well as your head. Now that is a great example of jihad. That's the reason the Holy Prophet chose you as his right hand and the best he had. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen said, if a person thinks well of you, make his idea hold true. Ya Abu Hassanain, having those two sons was as sons as well as a great warriors are so dear. One of the greatest miracles is when you prayed and asked Allah to change the direction of the sun. By answering your request, it was done. While crossing the Euphrates into Babylon with your love and devotion, mentioning Allah through your lips as you prayed was your intention. Ya Ali, Ya Wasi, you won in your birth as well as your death, while the poison sword took your last breath. Your enemies knew this is the only way to take you down. As Shia followers, you are our crown. They performed such a cowardly execution as you were performing your prayer with such dedication that this is why Allah put you in the Quran. You are the Ba in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Your name has been mentioned in the Holy Quran as Ali al-Hakim. You should always be mentioned in Eid al-Ghadir, as the Creator would so love you are His dear.